WIIFTBPM.
Family, I am Salim Muwakil, and I welcome you to Muwakil's World. I'm going to chop it up with Dr. Lance Williams, professor at Jacob Carruthers Center for Inner City Studies, and one of the most knowledgeable scholars of Chicago's street organizations.
During the doo-wop era, you wouldn't doing no doo-wop about what you was doing in the street. That was improper. What made rap so unique was that, for the first time, this is how we actually are living, especially at the bottom. So what happens is it becomes so popular because it's so raw. And ultimately, rappers realize that this is what sells and this is what the industry wants. So even guys who don't have authentically have those experiences and young women are rapping about it and having success. And after years of now this happening, it becomes known that, hey, this dude ain't really no real gangster. You know, this is a studio gangster. And what it did was music lost credibility because people thought they were listening to real gangsters rap. The sales of the music, which basically was being consumed by white suburban youth, this was their way of, it was a voyeuristic way of experiencing the hood, which they've always been fascinated with, without actually putting your life in danger. So you can listen to it. But once they found out, oh, these dudes ain't real, then even they stopped buying it. What's going on in the streets today? Because what the industry did was they realized, hey, the studio gangster thing ain't gonna work. So guess what? Let's go get some real gangsters that got the real credibility. But you know, when Chief Keef and these guys, so what we have expressed in the music scene today, when you deal with either, you know, trap, dancehall, but particularly drill music is the hot music.
That's right.
Nationally.
Right? And internationally.
And internationally, right? Which started right here on 63rd.
Old block.
So it's a shooting culture. So that's what they're rapping about. And that's what is hot, right? And so we saw the tragedy.
Fratricide is hot.
Yeah. That's what the tragedy of King Von, right? Of him, you know, he's a real dude. Now what happens is, because that's the model of success, everybody is following that. So everybody wants to be a shooter now. And what it's doing is it's driving a lot of the violence. In any culture, your music and your entertainment is a part of your cultural expression. So whenever you can have an extended period of time of a particular type of music that's having influence, it becomes a part of your culture. That's what Quab and I are saying in terms of his activism. I'm saying basically these radio stations are helping to produce a culture that's leading to the death and destruction of the black community so that they could sell, commodify, you know, their merch, mm-hmm. right? But, you know, we losing a lot of little brothers and sisters in the streets because of this, the way they think about things, how they see themselves, which they get from the music. Now, people are like, well, that's crazy that they're being influenced by music. They should be influenced by the values of their families. Ideally, yes, but the reality of the society that we live in is who has the biggest voice. And we know the media is the biggest voice in terms of ideals in the society that we live in.
If that fratricidal motif is being absorbed primarily by white listeners, who's the primary audience, yes. Why aren't they exhibiting this kind of behavior?
Because, first of all, it's not their identity.
Parenting in a Pandemic, powered by the Chicagoland Mom Squad, hosted by me, Tennille Jackson. Today's guest will be Beulah McLeod. It's not 2021 that this is getting fixed. Focus on your child and let's figure out what's going to work individually for you, but respect that people are making for them and don't shame them for them.
Everybody makes different choices for different reasons and you don't know what somebody's situation is, and equity is not giving everybody the same thing. Equity is giving everybody what he or she needs to be successful. If you want to do remote should be high quality. If you want to come back, it should be high quality. It's not necessarily about the mode of delivery. It's about what is the quality level of any of those particular modes. We have to have empathy. Right now, I can see the teachers' argument. A lot of them are scared. I get that, right? I get the parents' argument. Everybody experiences that level of, I don't know how to help my baby with this thing. So parents are frustrated. We got to just try to see each other's perspective, and I don't think we do enough of that. I think we get locked into our own viewpoint. This is what I think, and that's just it, and that's why we can never get to a solution. We need options, because everything is not going to be good for everybody.
Man, you know what I'm saying? So I'll be telling these niggas, man, shit in the game, man. Shit
tell them, done, man.
WIIFTVPN.
Is a lose-lose. I ain't got no love though.
truth. Pitiful piece of shit, shit, that's how them dudes do. 415s, fuck around and knock the screws loose. This flow is schizo, your boy go cuckoo. Yeah, I flew the coop too, you knew I had to get loose. Gun smokes the network, plug you in my Bluetooth. How can I shine if I don't try? If this is really mine, then why must I search for why it's so hard to find? Yes, I earn the right for me to pull it like triggers that trigger bullets. I bully the beat, take dimes from bass lines, snatch fails from snares, smack temples on cymbals, hi-hats beware. It sounds so simple, sounded so clear, so real like Real Madrid. I do it for...
This is a Treasure Gem. Traffic jam.
WIIFTBPN.
Right back at it. Live from the West End for the Black People Media Studios, it is now time to rock with the bigs back on the soil. I'm your man T. Tomlin, coming to you as usual with my player partner Eugene McIntosh.
What's the drawings, Brynowski?
It's another beautiful day, the most beautiful day of the year.
Man, Joe, what is this, about 63?
It's about 60. It's getting closer and closer to my kind
it's
of temperature.
It's a heat wave.
Let's okay. go. It felt like it was about 80 when I stepped out on yes. the deck this afternoon, well, this morning.
Yes, the breeze has me very breezy, and I love it, so.
Hey, man, I brought out one of my fan favorites since y'all was hating on, since y'all, you and Herb Howard was hating on LRG yesterday. So I said,
no,
I'm gonna bust out. I'm gonna bust out one of my all time favorite LRG joints. So here I am, man.
Just so you know, Gene hasn't like gained any weight since I've known him.
Actually, either. It's a little bit tighter. Okay. So I've gained about 10 pounds, okay. man. I went to the doctor and I was two hundred plus.
okay.
So I did gain a little weight, man. But yeah, you know,
muscle maybe.
You put it on in good Esco. Ways, right?
Thank y'all, man. Thank y'all. I appreciate that.
Yes, man. Shout out to everybody tuned in. Hope you guys are ready to have a good episode. We got a very special one planned for today. In about 10 minutes, man, we have a special guest on to go through his journey and his particular path.
Yes, sir.
But before that, you know, I got to check in with my brother and find out what his temperature is. What's going on with you today, Gino?
Man, it's all good, brother. Happy to be here. Blessed and highly favored, like Cousin 2 says, man. But I'm in the... May's doing the hard work out in the lobby.
Yes, sir.
And, man, coming to America, man. I know y'all watched it.
Okay, yeah. I did watch it Saturday night. Is it time for another Gino Ebert movie review? Kind of your day was good.
Yeah, it's all good. I mean, first off, I think people just needed to remove Coming to America, the original. Like, you had to just remove that out of your mind, out of your visual. Because this, if you were trying to compare the two, then you were going at it all wrong.
Yeah, man. I feel like we've seen enough movies in our time to understand you can't do that with a sequel. I couldn't do it with Anchorman. You can't do it with, you know what I mean, Rush Hour. You know what I mean?
Anchorman.
You got to come with kind of, to kind of see a new movie.
And especially 30 years later. Like, what do y'all expect?
Mm-hmm. Now, on that note, are you saying that you didn't like it? Like,
I wouldn't say I didn't like it. It wasn't raw, but
PG-13.
Number one, Coming to America was rated R. This one was PG-13.
Yeah.
So, what I did first was just not compare the two. Before I even hit play, okay. I said, "Let me fix my mind to go in, not trying to compare the two." Now. Okay. What I will say is there were some funny moments in there. I was more happy to see all the characters updated. So Randy Watson and Reverend Brown and
and the barbershop guys.
The barbershop was funny. That was funny. That was probably my favorite moment.
I thought it teethered the line of PG-13 and kind of more explicit adult jokes in that scene. I thought it was hilarious.
But I think think PG-13 because there was no PG-13 back then. It was only PG.
Okay.
So I feel like now,
the line was a little broader.
Now you can say whatever.
Walk the line of family movie.
Yeah.
Kind of more advanced comedy. Now here's where this is what I'll say about coming to America. I thought they did a good job of giving you the visual of what it's like to be in Zamunda in 2021. I thought
Zamunda in 2021, aka Rick Ross crib.
The craziest thing, they filmed the whole thing in his crib. I thought that was amazing. But I thought it visually looked good. I thought Eddie Murphy, again, shows you why he's one of the greats, because he can jump in and out of those characters. You know? and really shine still.
Yeah, no.
You know what I mean?
Yeah, I agree. The visual, it was visually stunning. Like I said, if you expected it to be anything like Coming to America.
First one was stunning.
Exactly. I mean, I thought they kept that from up from beginning to end. I liked the nostalgia of it. I thought they did a good job at every angle trying to remind you of this is a classic movie where we're making, like, it's hard. You know what I mean?
And I like how they tap back into, like, when we went to see how the actual Lavelle came.
Oh, that was, I thought that was genius. Yeah. And they tapped into technology.
The CGI.
Yeah, man. Crazy.
It was genius. So,
crazy.
So, yeah, you know what? It was actually, it was better than, I feel like, the people led it on to.
Because
it wasn't as bad as they made it seem.
Yeah, and that's the thing. Social media will ruin it for you. So, when you see all these different.
I've seen bad movies before.
I've seen a couple bad movies recently.
Yeah, and I feel like Eddie Murphy, his performance in it is enough to, like, entertain you throughout the length of the movie. You won't be mad you watched it.
So.
Great family film.
Yeah.
It was. It was good to see, like, Wesley Snipes. He was funny.
Another vet.
Yeah, he was wild.
What did you think about the daughter's son kind of storyline and the heir to the throne?
I kind of figured once I saw the daughters, I figured there would be
some type of
something would be there, with her being the heir to the throne, because obviously him coming back to America to find Lavelle, mm-hmm. we knew that he was trying to bring him back to Zamunda to be, you know, the heir to the throne. Mm-hmm. So when we saw how, you know, he trained with the daughters and all of that stuff, I knew that that would be, like, one of the plots
Should we say spoiler alert?
Hey, if you ain't seen it by now, you tripping. Todd Stroger may be the only one that I think hasn't seen the movie yet.
And that's
I was dying during the interview because it's so funny.
Which interview?
You remember the white guy interviewing him?
Yes.
You know, I read a lot of studies when I was in school.
Colin, yeah. And he played the grandson of the cats from Trading Places.
It was Pills?
Yeah.
Yeah. What was my boy's name? Did he go? Mortimer and
Watermeyer and the other dudes.
Mortimer.
And you brought up a good aspect as far as everybody seeing it. I feel like if this had opened in movie theaters, it would have did really, really well over the weekend. I feel like you would have had packed movie theaters. And I think people's first impression would have been a little better if they got to see it in a movie theater as opposed to streaming, but I got to rewind and laugh at a couple of things. The 10 candle joke. She said, "I need 31 candles out of 10. I'm like, if that ain't my crib. I was busting up at that one.
There were a few funny moments in there. It's like, again, Twitter, Facebook, Instagram. You know, they'll ruin it for you. So I had to make sure I cleanse my soul.
I don't know if some of those people actually saw
the movie. They went in with Coming to America on their minds, man.
It's like, if you want to watch Coming to America, it's available on Amazon Prime. Go ahead, play it. It's great still. You know what I mean? Coming to America, I feel like I enjoyed it, especially we got a taste and an update of all the characters. The queen wasn't in it. I feel like she was the only one missing.
And I think she may have passed.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Oh wow.
Yeah.
Okay.
And
it was the
little barber.
Yeah.
You ain't never met Martin Luther King.
Yeah, I know he passed. Yeah.
Oh, he did.
Yeah. The actor who played him passed.
Okay.
But they gave a good little note. It's like, okay, what would the Queen do?
Right.
I thought that was a nice nod to her because she was in the first one.
Voice
the more
reason.
Wise one. Yeah,
because she was the one telling them, "You the king, man. You make the rules, man."
Exactly.
Like
you telling me following rules?
Right.
I thought you was the king.
Right.
Yeah, I mean, that's a great line. But yeah, you know, I'm probably going to end up watching it again.
Just so you have to.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So
me too.
Yeah. I feel like anybody that hasn't seen it, you're in for a decent night. Go ahead and enjoy it.
Coming to America.
And I know people got the you can set your setup up outside, get your drive-in feel back is 60 for the next few days. Go ahead, watch it outside.
60 for the next few days?
It's 60 mm-hmm. for the next few days, like the next two or three days, bro. Yes.
You know what that
coming
means.
Coming in a little bit before April 1st, Gino.
Yeah, you know
I'm
what
grilling.
That means.
I'll meet you at the lake. Where y'all want to meet at?
Gino, name the plot. I mean, the spot, nigga. Be going.
I don't think any part of the lake, you know, it used to be like, man, 31st, or it used to be like North Avenue. It's all the same now.
People were actually pulling up over in between the Shedd Aquarium.
That's where it is, though.
It was freezing. It was cold last couple of days, though.
You know what was funny to me? Yesterday, driving on Lakeshore Drive and seeing people over there on the lake.
Bruh.
With snow on the rocks.
It's still
golfing
ice
with
in the
snow
water.
on the grass.
It's brick by the lake, okay?
Let's go.
Well, you can't tell me I'm not in Miami. You can't tell me that.
You could. I swear, yesterday, I'm like, man, people are that. I mean,
oh, yeah.
Obviously, since we've been indoors for a whole year, people are taking. And now that Lori Moe is, you know, lighting up.
Yes, and yeah, because we got to make sure we get to that before the end of the show.
All right.
But, yes, it's that time for baseball fans in Chicago. I'm pretty sure you may have seen the news already, but, yes. I think 20% of fans will be allowed on both sides of town at Wrigley and guaranteed rate on opening day and moving forward throughout the season. So
what is she? They're starting at what, 20% of the ballpark?
Starting at 20% and giving first dibs to season ticket holders. And I think we guessed that on the last show. So season ticket holders, I think, are going to be starting getting emails this week. The White Sox actually are having a Zoom that I'm going to not be able to make, but I had to hit up the White Sox because I did have a question. They made their marketing advisor available for the first time in a while.
Today?
Yeah. And the only thing I really want to know is how this affects the sales staff that had to be laid off because they weren't selling tickets. So I want to know if it's going to have any impact on jobs on that front. Mm. I mean, because if you're going to have fans, it's time to get these people back in and have an opportunity to get back to the way things were before the pandemic. I know it's probably a sticky situation when you look at how many people have been fired or laid off from the MLB across the MLB.
Yep.
You know what I mean? So the White Sox are one of the teams that have kind of avoided any major layoffs, but they still had to make some. So, I got to see what's going on that front.
And what about, the season ticket holders and who's going to get first dibs?
Yeah, and it's like, okay, like, what's the rate? Are the season tickets, how many people gave up the season tickets because they couldn't afford them over the last year? So,
It's still going to be sky high. The ticket prices are going to be sky high.
Things for sure.
Crazy, man. But I'm pretty sure, the guys, resume, getting back to some type of normalcy. We see it in spring training a little bit, especially at Sloan Park.
That's been dope.
Yeah.
I feel like it's been super noticeable. It's like, oh, my God, it's fans here.
Yeah, the authentic fan noise versus
the automated fan noise.
Yeah, it was like.
I be feeling old at the bar, but I'm like, turn that down. Can you turn that down?
Yeah, it just doesn't have the same aesthetic.
No, at all.
And then, especially at Wrigley when they got the fake vendors.
Oh.
Hot dogs.
Beer. Peanuts.
I miss peanuts? Dude. Hot dogs.
Nah, give beer. You got to pass the money down. Nobody's doing that. Yeah, cash only.
So White Sox fans consume the most beer or the most liquor in the Major League Baseball, huh?
Probably because it is the cheapest. I mean, you can go and get you an IPA for $3 on Tuesdays.
It's that guarantee. Walk from the parking lot.
Oh, yeah.
Thirsty.
Then the right, what is that section in right field?
You got the beer cave. That is off the chain where you get to taste all kind of beers. Like, I've been in there with the bros. It's dope. I mean, for the fan experience, guaranteed rate has it. You know what I mean? The beer cave is dope. They don't have a piss beer. You know what I mean? They keep live.
They got a live beer selection. Yeah. I have to give them props. They have a super live beer selection.
And it's probably the best prices around. You can go in there and get lit for real.
So, yeah, you can spend a 40-pack and.
Coming out with a dub, you leave a happy
You're
fan.
Not going to do that at Wrigley.
No.
No, you come in there with a 40-pack in Wrigley, might get...
You got to put it in your foot bag.
You might get 3 Budweiser.
You might get. You probably can get one of those tall, hard alcohol drinks with like a drop of Captain Morgan in it. You may be able to get that for a dub, but you ain't going to be satisfied.
I don't know if I think the only IPA they have at Wrigley Field is like the 312.
Yeah, that's totally the only one, yeah.
Come on, guys.
The food has improved at Wrigley, though, so...
Oh, good times.
You know what? I want to talk to our audience though. So, are you gonna end up at any baseball games? You think
it's kind of a tradition for us?
Okay,
every opening game.
Yes, oh, that's special.
But now that it's limited, I mean, y'all need help carrying your bags in there.
Oh yeah,
when we broadcast.
So you just walk right into it. Just give them a nod. I'm with the brothers. You good? Yes.
On that note. Let's take our break. We come
it.
Back on the other side. We have our special guest for the day, one of Chicago's finest. And you can't talk about Chicago basketball at all if we ain't putting my man in the conversation. So we will be back on the other side of the break. Esco, take us to break. We'll be back. You're on the soil with the bigs.
WIFTBPN.
Sissy's Taco Bar Pop-Up is back with more hours and more days. Check them out at their new pop-up location at The Woodlawn, located 1200 East 79th Street. Sissy's Taco Bar offers authentic street tacos infused with international soul. Now every Tuesday, Thursday, Friday, and Saturday at The Woodlawn from 12 p.m. to 7 p.m. New vegan tacos have been added to the menu too. Visit sissytacobar.com for more info.
My name is Cassandra J. Mads, current Village of Olympia Fields trustee and your candidate for Village President of Olympia Fields. I've been a resident of Olympia Fields for 28 years. I believe in building strategic partnerships, establishing governance boundaries, and have and will continue to dedicate my life's work as a respected and credible voice when it comes to decision making. Olympia Fields has always been a community of familiarity and comfort, and I want to make sure the village stays that way. On Tuesday, April 6th, vote Cassandra J. Matz for your Olympia Fields Village President. Paid for by Citizens for Cassandra J. Matz.
No bullshit at the pulpit with questions for the reverend, like why I gotta die to go to heaven, or are these lies and deception a sign of what's next to deny my progression to my soul through my spirit from my mind and my flesh? You be hard pressed to alter my perspective. It's reflective of my perception. Dying quick, effects from environments neglected, disconnected, disrespected. This the same section we never invest in. Our own sales, sales from our own shells, become owners on our own. They get on with our own help. Yeah, creators of our own world, communicate. We accumulated our own wealth, created in this image. So when I say it, I meant it. Do the science for yourself. My brothers and sisters, we ain't niggas and bitches. My brothers and sisters, we ain't niggas and bitches. Can you dig that though? And I put this on my mama, Black Madonna, Mother Earth, Mother Africa. I'm honored to be a part of where it started, selling starbird through the stars, stardust on my starship. My heartbeat is godly. I'm the light harnessed from the darkest part of darkness. Such a godsend. I teach my son to treat your daughter like a goddess. I teach my daughter to treat your son like a god king. I can never deny my fate.
WIFTVPN.
Fortunately, my fortune awaits. Majority of the world, minority in the States. Yeah, we blossom from the concrete. The world copies what they see, then mocks my mystique. The possibilities impossible to see. The ways of Western man can't match the prophets of the East. My brothers and sisters, we ain't niggas and bitches. My brothers and sisters, we ain't niggas and bitches. Young brother, young king, you're a genius. Young sister, young queen, supreme beings. All you have to do is believe it. All you gotta do is believe it. Young brother, young king, you're a genius. Young sister, young queen, supreme beings. All you gotta do is believe it.
Y'all niggas, and you gon' be niggas forever, just like us niggas. You're not niggas.
WIFTVPN.
We are back now on the soil, man. Hope everybody tuned in. It's having a beautiful Monday. Right, Sonya? I know you feel me. If nobody feels me, I know Sonya's going to feel me.
Yeah. A beautiful Monday, man. You know, such a beautiful Monday afternoon. Happy to be here on the soil with everybody. Peace to the family members. Peace to the gods. Everybody in here rocking with the brothers, man. We most definitely appreciate it. Before we continue, man, we need everybody to smash that like button. Smash that share button, hit the comments, join the conversation like you guys always do. Continue to help us and the What's In It for the Black People Media push the content and the culture forward, man. It's all about owning the black voice And it's either, it's now or never, man. We getting further away from who we are, letting other people tell our stories, and nobody can tell our stories better than we can, man. So continue to help us push the content forward and continue to support us over here. But, man, with that being said, we got our special guest in the building today. Man, ain't no talking about Chicago basketball history without mentioning this guy right here. And, you know, it's a lot of talk about, you know, giving people their flowers while they're still here.
It's important.
And, man, P-Mac, you there, brother?
Man, you know I'm here, my dude, man. I'm definitely appreciate you, my guy.
For those that don't know, from South Shore High School through Kennedy King, DePaul Blue Demons, all the way to the NBA, Phoenix Suns, Golden State Warriors, and many stops in between, man. P-Mac been all over the world.
Yes, sir.
But, man, like I said, one of Chicago's legends, and, man, personally one of my top five favorite guys in the history of Chicago basketball to watch, man. So we'll get into that further down the line.
Man,
but
that's strong, man.
Hey,
that's
look strong. Here, man. That's look strong, here, P-Mac. We gonna get into that, brother. But first of all, man, how you doing, man?
Man, I'm good, bro. Man, appreciate you, man, for letting me share your platform, man. And, you know, I'm still maintaining, man. Trying to get back and do some lot of things with the kids now. But, you know, definitely happy to be on the soil and, you know, sharing the platform with you, my brother.
We appreciate you, man. You like the true representation of what on the soil means and stands for, man. It's like, you know, I think the term originated from the crib. We are producers of a lot of slang that people take and, you know, spin it into their own way. But on the soil is like some official Chicago slang. And like I said, you one of the official representations of on the soil. So, man, I just want to kick it off from the beginning, man, and we can take it from there. So, you grew up in Sercon, right?
Yeah, I grew up on 75th in Dorchester, born and raised. Attended grammar school around elementary school, James on 74th in Dorchester. Got kicked out in sixth grade and ended up going to a Catholic school on Stony Island, St. Albie, for 2 years. But, you know, always been from around there, man. That's the hood that made me. Shaped me, molded me, turned me into the player I was and the person I was. So definitely never forget about Dorchester and Sercon and where I came from.
Nah, you know, I didn't know you went to St. Albie, man. I know that means I got family that's worked in that school, so I'm pretty sure you probably ran across them. But, man.
Man, I definitely went there for 2 years, man.
That's crazy. I didn't know that. But, man, you talk about, you know, growing up and your surroundings basically shaping you as a basketball player. I guess the first thing I would love to know is, when did you know that you had something special? And from that point, how did that affect you moving forward?
It was, I ain't gonna lie, bro, to be honest, it was like different phases. Coming into high school, I wasn't really like the hottest recruit, you know what I'm saying? And I was in the era of, at the time, coming into high school, some of the best players was Brian Notre from Simeon, Michael Herman. Ronnie Fields was one of the top players, but he was an underclassman at the time. So, you know, when I first got in, I had to prove I belonged on a high school level. So at South Shore, I started on varsity as a sophomore because a lot of people didn't remember that Don Pittman left South Shore and went to Carver. And he took, like, the whole team from South Shore and took them to Carver with him. So anybody left on the South Shore team was pretty much leftovers or guys that Pittman didn't want, you know what I'm saying? And so I went there as a sophomore, made varsity, and initially I had to prove to the seniors and older guys that I was good enough. And once I proved that I could show them and I saw that I had a skill and a talent that they couldn't stop, I wanted to see how far I could take my gift. So, you know, each step of the way, it was about proving that you belong. For me, the college, whether it was JUCO, whether it was the pro-am at IIT, whether it was the NBA, it was just about letting the people know that you on the court with that, you know, I'm somebody special, I deserve to be here, and I'm a problem too.
So, P-Mac, were you 95 or 96?
I was 96. I came out in 96, me and Ronnie Fields.
Right.
95 was KG and Michael Herman, and you know, they was loaded too, man. And it was crazy in that time. If you was hooping in the early 90s, man, it was crazy, man. It was crazy in Chicago. Now a lot of talent.
Now check it out. Now Mike Herman was my year. I was 94. I played at Mount Carmel with Twan. So Mike was my year.
Yeah.
Another one of my top five favorite guys to
Marlo
watch. Marlo. Yeah. Marlo was my backup. Marlo was a sophomore, and he was my when I went out, Marlo subbed in for me. And Marlo went So
Marlo went to Tulane. Marlo ended up going to Tulane.
Yeah, he did. So over there at South Shore, I know it was you and Joel Bullock. Was Joel 95 or 96?
Joel was 96 as well, but Joel just, me and Joel only played 1 year together. I got him to transfer from Hales to come to South Shore to play with me, but I was always a fan of Joel game, man. I would watch Joel years before I played against him, before I played with him, playing against him. He went to Grimmer School, 73rd and Jeffrey, and I went to James Madison on 74th. So I got to see Joel before a lot of people. I've been knew Joel had games. So, man, when he was interested in thinking about leaving Hales, I was recruiting and pitching and trying to get that man to come give me some help. But, man, he was one of the most underrated, slept-on point guards to walk through Chicago, in my opinion. I might be biased, but, man, he was tough to me, bro. He was so tough to me.
Man, just listening to the history, you know, behind the scenes, this is all before my time. You know what I mean? I'm looking back on it like, wow, the high school scene was operating more like a professional scene or a collegiate scene than what I know the high school scene to be in my time. I mean, so what I basically would love to know is, what were some of your most, like, crucial battles outside of, you know, the high school court that got you into the conversation of these guys and that, like you said, that special time of Chicago basketball?
Man, I had a lot of battles. They started in the streets before I even got to get into high school or to IIT or to where most people took notice of me. It was a rapper named Sly Polaroid. He was real
all
cool
day
with Bump J.
All day.
His real name, Kenneth Vershaw, and Ken had stupid game. He's from the east side too, so you know, he had his guys, and all my guys was GDs, and Ken had his guys, they were Stones. So he was one of the first people I ever like locked up with and played a game. I went to his hood, played against him in front of all Black Stones, and I'm the only GD there. So it was crazy to even think that I got out of there with a win and made it. So that was my first introduction to, like, man, one-on-one, bully ball, fight to survive, scratching, clawing. You, like, you worried about if you're going to get up out to the park and make it home and count your little money, you know what I'm saying? And for me, that was how we made money. Like, I didn't come from a lot of money growing up, so, you know, people in the streets, everybody found their player that they liked, and they backed them, and they bet, and they put you against somebody else. So that was how I met Bobby Smith. That was how I met Twan. That was how I met a lot of the people in the streets, was from me playing other people in the streets. So by the time I got to the high school and caught them guys later at IIT, it wasn't really a problem. But some of my biggest, earliest, first battles was me and Sly used to go at it. I played Tony Allen early. He was young. I went in the Calumet buildings and played Tony Allen. I beat a young Tony Allen before he got to be who he was. And I would just go everywhere and travel to, you know, try to play people, man. I ain't really care who or where you was. And I just chased people. I chased Ronnie Fields for probably a summer and a half trying to play him because he was so elite and everybody knew who he was. I was just trying to, you know, catch up to him and show him that, you know, Southside got some killers too, and we got somebody that's high flying and somebody coming and somebody can do everything you can do.
Man, I know all about that story about you and Sly, man. I'm part of the history too, man. So I know about them battles firsthand. So people don't know Sly had game, Joe.
And he was like 6'5", way back in the 90s. Like, man, that boy was so tall.
No, Sly was the truth, man.
That's
but
crazy.
Yeah, yeah. So, it, you know, like he said, man, the streets is where you get your stripes. then that's why when you get to high school, college, and all the rest of that, it's like a breeze because you done been through it all. Once you, if you, if
it's
you
like make stealing, it the, like all, stealing, bro,
all day, bro. So you at South Shore, and then I know you ended up. So you played with the Illinois Fire, right?
Yeah, I played with the Illinois Fire. Yeah, definitely did.
And that's now the Mac Irvin Fire. So you play with I know Jimmy Sanders.
I played under the daddy coached me. Jimmy Sanders, Ronnie Fields, what was that big man? Man, went to Fresno State, lefty. I'm looking dead at him. Randy Holcomb.
Randy Holcomb, yep.
Randy Holcomb played with me. Aaron McGee played with me. We had a nice team. Melvin Eli was on that team.
Yeah.
We was loaded. We lost to Arizona team in Vegas, Mike Bibby and some more players, but we was loaded, bro. That Illinois Fire 96 team was loaded.
So you get done 96, you get done at South Shore. How did you end up at Kennedy King? Because I'm going to tell you a story that you probably don't even remember.
I first left South Shore and I went to a JUCO in Tallahassee, Florida.
Right.
Called TCP. Yeah. That was the number one junior college in the nation. We lost the championship that year to Indian Hills. Indian Hills was ranked number two. We finished like 35-2. I'm the second leading scorer. We had a kid named Boosie Thornton, ended up going to St. John's and scored like 40 on Duke. He was on that team with me too, but I got kicked out of there after my first year because I came back to Chicago when I wasn't supposed to.
Right.
Feeling myself. We had a weekend off, you know what I'm saying? And the coach like, man, don't go back home, nobody. We got practice Sunday. Now, this is like Thursday night. So I'm thinking, man, I can make it to Chicago and I'll be back for practice Sunday. You know what I'm saying? Like, man, I'm finna try and get to the shot. I missed the crib. Came home, missed practice coming back. Didn't make it coming back in time, man. Me and my guy kicking it, BSing around in the streets, man, just being stupid. Missed the practice to get back Sunday. I called my coach on the way back from like, we in like Alabama somewhere. I'm like, coach, I got a flat, man. I'm stuck on the other side of town. I'm trying to act like I'm in Tallahassee.
All day.
The man already knew I wasn't in Tallahassee because somebody on the team told him I went back to Chicago. So he said, man, I don't care where you at. I don't know where you at. But wherever you at, turn back around and go back home. I'm through with you. Mm. Now, I'm coming off a freshman year where I shot 72%. I averaged 16 points. We was 35-2, and we lost the championship at Hutch. So I'm feeling myself. I'm just knowing he going to let me slide. Man, that man cut me. Like, I will never forget that to this day. I felt so down and empty, man. I didn't know what to do. So I called back home, and the coach at Kennedy King was a guy named Willie Little, legendary coach, man, in Chicago, coached at Manly, coached a lot of players, man. He reached out to me and just took me under his wing, guided me. I sat out that next year and just watched to get my grades right. And then the next year I went to Kennedy King and he kind of just helped me begin to blossom as a player. And like, he let me dribble the ball and like be a guard and shoot shots when other coaches always used me close to the basket because of my strength and my athleticism. Mm-hmm. Willie Little was the first one to let me just, man, bring the ball up. I could shoot threes if I wanted. He never really harped on me about, like, no, don't do this, no, don't do that, like most coaches did. So once I went there, like, I just got an extra confidence in my game flourishing. Then from there, I went to DePaul.
Did Tripp play with you in Florida, Tyron Triplett?
Absolutely, Tripp played with me, Tripp, Jimmy Sanders, Boosie, all of them, man. We was so loaded, man. Tyron Triplett, one of the best shooters I ever seen in my life.
Ever.
Definitely played with me. Big bucket getter, man. That's my guy too, man. Shout out to Tripp.
So check it out. So when you got to Kennedy King, so you remember Corey Brown?
I definitely remember Corey Brown from Morgan Park. CB,
yes, sir.
Man.
Yes, sir. Guy. Murder, man. So I got it in with y'all one day before a game. And then y'all literally went out and destroyed some people by about 50 at Kennedy King. And I'll never forget, bro, I'll never forget. Somebody shot a jumper. It came off long. And Corey will tell this story to this day. He says he went up, and I was in the stands. He went up for the rebound. And before he could jump, he said he felt a foot on his head. And it was you. And you called it classic P-Mac, catching it over everybody, putting it back in. But I remember the play, but he says when he before he jumped, he felt a foot on his head. And Corey was 6'4".
On his head.
On his head.
Yeah, Corey, so he was 6'4", man. I used to just, I don't know, I had a knack, man. I was always uber, like, super athletic. I just had a knack for, like, I was taught earlier, if somebody shoot, you got to come from the opposite side. Like, I had a guy in my neighborhood named Wayne Irvin, legendary dude to us in our neighborhood. Played at Chicago State, mm-hmm. played at Wyoming,
okay.
played against Patrick Ewing. He passed away a couple years ago, but went to CVS. He was a decorated player. A lot of people knew him. And he taught me early, like, you attack offensive rebounds from the opposite side. So if somebody shoot from the left wing, you crash from the right. If somebody shoot from the top of the key, you can crash because it can go either way and you can get it. And I was so big and athletic. I used to get a lot of tip dunks. Like, for some reason, people never boxed me out. And once I got a running start, if it came off anywhere over the rim and bounced up, you was dead. Like, wasn't no chance to stop me.
That's crazy to think. Gino, of course you would. I always play with Gino. He's always somewhere in the middle of Chicago basketball history.
I was there, bro.
Every nook and cranny of it. But, Paul, man, the story you told about where you got to Kennedy King, man, it, of course it resonates because I feel like with any Chicago hooper, overcoming hurdles is part of the game. You know what I mean? I feel like it's one of the lessons that everybody learns on their path. But what were some of the voices, you know, that were prevalent and you know, in your circle around that time, people trying to keep you on the right path?
I had a lot of guys around me, man. I had both my parents, first of all. So, you know, that's where my foundation came from. I came from a household with a mother and a father that I saw every day, and I saw them work. My street ties and street affiliation came because I just jumped off the porch and wanted to get in the streets. I didn't really even have to do some of that stuff I did. I had two good parents with two good jobs. Them usually the kids that jump off the porch and be in the streets. So, you know, all my guys was single parent households, man, wasn't going to school. Them was all my friends. So, you know, once I jumped out there, like, man, it was crazy to me, man. It was just so crazy to me. And those experiences helped me, like, it molded me, bro. Like, when I was young, I was hot-headed. I used to gang bang. I was GD crazy. I got shot. I got stabbed. I could have easily not made it to be what I became. You know what I'm saying? By the grace of God, I made it, lucked up. But it's a lot of people that was just as talented or more talented than me that's that came to the streets or that didn't make it. You know, for every Paul McPherson, it's a Brand Leach or, you know, somebody, man. Michael Herman or somebody who should have made it that didn't. You know what I'm saying? So I carried their weight too. Like, you know, we was all underdogs. So, you know, I just tried to, man, uphold the reputation of our city. I knew that Chicago was known for having killers. And so when people saw me and knew I was from Chicago, I never wanted anybody to be like, oh, how he ain't one of them dudes. Like, you know, I wanted to leave an impression wherever I went, whoever I played. So that all stemmed from where I grew up at and you know, how I was raised.
Classic, man. Like you, the names, you know, like you said, Mike Herman, another one of my top five favorite guys to tap in with. He was my year. I went to summer school with Mike, played against him a few times from Hales to Western House to King. Mike is one of the illest of all. Like, you remember, and we're going to get into IIT later down the line, but when he gave Randy Brown that 50, that 60 piece.
60, boy, yeah, 50, 60.
Some
57. We rounded it up. We say 60 because if you go 57, I'm rounding it up.
That's straight.
Nobody else goes 57.
But
man, Herm was tough, man.
Herm was he was ridiculous.
Crazy.
All right, so you leave Kennedy King, and we know what was bubbling. You ain't. I mean, I know why you chose DePaul, but. Who else was recruiting you? And I mean, obviously I know why you chose DePaul, but for the people who may not know, you know, talk about that recruiting process.
Crazy story, man. This is a true life story. Lance Williams from Julian was one of my best friends. I played against Quentin, Lance, Bobby, all of them, right? So as I'm watching them their first year there, they got the city buzzing. You know what I'm saying? Like, man, Q killing, Last killing, Bobby killing. I'm like, ooh, I'm starting to get like an itch. Like, man, all they need is a couple more pieces. You know what I'm saying? Man, I definitely can help fooling them out. You know, like, let me get in. DePaul was not even recruiting me. Like, this is a true story, bro. Mm. From Chicago, been killing, tearing the city up. They initially wanted Ronnie, right? Which I couldn't have been mad at, because in high school, Ronnie was more polished than me.
Right.
Even though I thought I could do everything just as good as him. In high school, Ronnie was like Jordan through the city. Right. You know what I'm saying? Right. I was like Dominique or somebody. You know what I'm saying? So DePaul wanted Ronnie. When Ronnie got in an accident and wasn't going to qualify, I'm knowing I'm the next one up. I'm like, oh, they got to get me. Then they wanted Jimmy Sanders after Ronnie ahead of me. So I was in my feelings now at this point. I'm actually finna go to Cincinnati. I was about to sign and go to the University of Cincinnati, because Bob Huggins loved JUCO players. Yep. He had came down to the All-Star game, watched me win MVP. Man, that man took me out to eat. I was literally like 2 days from signing, going to Cincinnati. Tracy Dealey comes as I come back, because the rumor's starting to sound like that I might go to Cincinnati. Wow. Tracy Dealey was the main reason why I went there, along with Lance. I wanted to play with Quentin and Bobby and just like build something. But at the time, like, people was pushing me and Quentin against each other, like rivals, you know what I'm saying? But Quentin was 2 years younger than me. I didn't really try to get into that, but you know how the city just make you become a rival with somebody, you know what I'm saying? You ain't necessarily got no beef with this dude or nothing. It's just somebody think he better than you, and before you know it, y'all standing face to face, finna play each other in a one-on-one for a few thousand somewhere at some park. So I just wanted to go and play and see what all of us could do together on one team. We all was from Chicago. We had a 7-footer, Steve Hunter, coming to help us out. We had another kid from Michigan, Kerry Hartfield,
who was
a McDonald's All-American. He was coming. So, you know, I wanted to just stay home, man. I wanted to put on for my city. I wanted my guys and my family to be able to come see me play. And a lot of people thought I wouldn't, like, man, you ain't going to make it. You ain't going to start. You're going to come off the bench. That's Q team. That's this and that's that. And once I got there, they knew I was a killer. Bobby and them knew. Lance knew. Q knew. All of them knew. Like, man, dude, I ain't backing down from none of y'all. I'm here to help y'all, but I ain't scared of none of y'all. And so that was the beginning of probably the most, man, I would say, like, I went to the league for 2 years, which was really short, and I played overseas 8 years. Those 6-7 months at DePaul was probably the best time of my life playing with them dudes, man.
Man, so why was it just 6-7 months? Because I know you were deciding between the league and DePaul. What was it that ended up convincing you that it was time for the league?
I kind of used Quentin as a measuring stick, to be honest with you, to tell you the truth, bro. As I'm coming in, Quentin already the man. And he was a projected lottery pick that year, even though he ended up dropping and going. I think he went 18 that year we went. But initially, he was a lottery top 10 pick, right? So I'm practicing against him every day. We never on the same team. I'm always going against him. I never wanted to, like, the first day there, they do starters against the reserves. I tell Tracy Dealey, put me on the reserve team. I got cute. Like, this the first day we get to practice. So initially, like, everybody like, oh shit, here come, you know what I'm saying? Here they go with this. And I just used Q as a measuring stick. Like, Q was a tremendous rebounder. He could shoot. He started to develop his shot. Yeah. But I saw things in this game that I could do that he couldn't do. Mm. And it was things that he could do that I couldn't do. So as we started to battle and eventually became teammates and helped one another, I felt like if it was some games where Q wasn't the leading scorer and I was the leading scorer. At Duke, I was the leading scorer and he was, you know, had a tough night, and it was some nights where I had tough nights and he went off. So I kind of used him for my barometer, you know what I'm saying? He ended up averaging 17 that year. I averaged 15.6, but the system was designed for Q. So if I would have stayed, I definitely felt like I could have averaged more than 16.6 that next year. But I was just thirsty, ready to leave, man. And I was so mad the way we lost in the tournament. I finished that last game against Kansas, a double overtime game with 26 points. I fouled out, and we lost. And it was like 10, 12 scouts there to see Q. Q had about 18, missed a lot of shots. I was like, shit, I'm leaving. I'm finna try it. Like, ain't nothing else to do. Yeah. Ain't nothing else to come back for. I feel like I can make it, and I'm a bet on myself. And a lot of people, you know, people that was close to me thought I had a chance, but a lot of people said, you know, what are you doing? You stupid. Why you leaving early? Cute leaving, so stay next year, and it's going to be your team. Like, I heard it from so many different places on, like, not to leave, but I just had it in my heart that I felt like I was good enough and I wanted to bet on myself.
Real. So the bet, obviously the bet paid off. What was that NBA process like? What was going through the camps and, you know, playing against guys that
crazy,
you watched?
Man.
Yeah.
It was crazy because I actually, like, had a little – initially I signed with Mark Bartlestein in Priority Sports, one of the biggest agencies in Chicago. So, you know, we had workouts, and I worked out for Philly, I worked out for Denver, I worked out for Phoenix, and I worked out for Cleveland. And I'm going up against Jamal Crawford, Mike Miller in these workouts. Q was in one of the workouts. Keon Doolin was so tough from Missouri, played for Clippers.
Yeah.
So I'm going against, like, all lottery caliber guards. And I was killing. They couldn't stop me from getting to the basket. Like, so I felt like, man, like, as long as I keep working and develop, like, none of them were strong enough for me. None of them. Everybody had their different strength. Like, you know, Q had developed into a shooter. Q just all of a sudden went from an undersized post player to a three-point shooter with a big body like a guard. Right. So, you know, you had to, like, try to change your game and work. So, you know, once I got in those workouts and those pro workouts, which was crazy, you working out for 2-3 hours, constantly running, you playing 3-on-3 full court. Like, I wasn't ready for none of that, bro, none of that. And the workouts just gave me confidence. Like, it was just all about knowing that you can belong and knowing that you're not out of place. And I fit with whoever get on the court. And that was just the beginning of, like, you know, I never was scary anyway. So once I saw that, you know, I was even able to compete, my mentality and my heart just wouldn't let me not go down. And I just came out being aggressive, trying to score, and ended up signing a 2-year deal with Phoenix in 2000.
Now, it's, you know, one of the things that I feel like I encounter most when I talk to ex-players from the league, man, they always have something to say about the politics of it, you know, whether it be, you know, D. Rose or Gilbert Arenas. I feel like the politics of it is a side that rubs the realest of, you know, hoopers in the league the wrong way. Now, in your 2-year stint, what was it like? You know what I mean? Was it what you dreamed of, or was it something that you was like, you know what, I can do without this? Which, you know, did it make you more susceptible to playing outside of the country?
Nah, definitely. It was actually the opposite way. It was everything I dreamed of and then more, right? Like, it got a political aspect to it as well, because it's a billion-dollar industry. So, you know, it's governed by a body, and it got billionaire owners, and it's a lot of people that run the NBA machine. But at the same time, it's nothing like I came from instant noodles and food stamps. Like, it's nothing like riding on the back of luxury Lear jets and fully stocked with food and all the drinks and they giving you money to do this on, like, you would do this shit for free, and they give you, like, per diem, and the per diem, like, $1,500 for every city. So you got a 3 or 4 city road trip, you might easily get $6,000 on top of your salary. Now, this is just to hang out with and be safe in the town you're going to. Like, I never, like, I was like, what? So this on top of the salary that I signed for every road trip, every city, I'm finna get $1,500, like, just to go do whatever money, like, per what? Nah, that was the life, bro. And I really, one of the things for me I regret is not taking it more serious and taking it for granted.
Right.
Like, I felt like once I got there, I made it. And really, once you get there, that's when all the work starts. You know what I'm saying? And me, I never really put the work in that people do now. Like, you see guys, I tell kids now, if you go to the gym one time a day, which when I was coming up, you was considered a gym rat. If you're doing that today, that's not nowhere near good enough. Like, you're going to be so far behind the eight ball, you ain't going to be nowhere near ready for what you think you need to be ready for. So, you know, I just, man, it was lessons. I made a lot of mistakes. I was rough around the edges, But at the end of the day, I think, you know, God look out for babies and fools, and I wasn't no baby. So he had his hand on me, man, and he helped me, and I was able to come through it. But, man, the NBA was everything I ever dreamed of and more.
And that's funny because another one of your guys, and this is how I kept tabs, not tabs on you, but just how I kept up with you. You know, you really had to be tapped in to know what was going on with guys like you who weren't like, you know, top draft picks or wasn't, you know, faces of franchises, but from the crib. And we wanted to make sure y'all was good. So I came up playing Little League Baseball with your, with Reggie, with Reg Brown.
Oh, word. Yeah, Reg's my guy, man. That's my brother, man.
Yes,
I ain't know that white boy.
Yes, sir, man. So I used to keep, you know, I would hit Reg up just to make sure you, I would see you catching oops from J-Kid or, you know, doing your thing, you know. And I'm just, I would hit Reg up like, man, how's Paul doing? You know, we see him on TV. Everybody at the crib is happy for him. You know, I'm glad that y'all, you know, stay in the course. And again, you know, we
quick
from the
story,
crib.
Bro. I'm catch
no,
you
go
up,
ahead. But no, go ahead.
Quick
go
story
ahead.
About me and Reg. Reg is who I was with when I went back to Chicago from Tallahassee.
Because he was at
he
FAMU.
He was going to FAMU.
Yes, sir.
He was going to FAMU at the time, and he was playing baseball. And I was going to Tallahassee, and I'm playing basketball. So I'm like, bro, we got a couple days. Let's sneak back to the crib. Reg's like, oh, hell yeah, let's go back. We supposed to left Sunday morning, man. We kicking it. I can't find this fool. Man, we ain't leave this Sunday afternoon at 4:30. Man, so when the coach tell me to stay back and turn around and go back to Alabama, Reg in the car waiting for me. Now, this is before cell phones. I stopped at a payphone. I come back to the car. Reg's like, man, damn, what's wrong, bro? I said, man, Gillespie just said, shit, don't even come back to Tallahassee. Man, turn around and go back to Chicago. Reg felt so bad because he knew that we shouldn't have went. He was driving. Mm-hmm. He was like, man, I shouldn't even made you come, man. Damn, man. So once I officially got kicked off, Reg felt bad about that for like 2-3 years when really it was my decision to do it, man. But yeah, Reg my guy, man. I ain't mean to go all off into that. But man, that's my brother, man. I just seen him last week.
No, we needed that. That's a part of your history, man. Like I said, I used to tap in with Reg like every couple weeks when I would see you on SportsCenter and just him, just to make sure y'all was good, tap in, and, you know, just to check the vibes. But getting back to the league, man, how was it, like, playing with J-Kid? I say, man, look at Paul catching oops. Like, bro, catching – we watching you from the crib on SportsCenter catching oops from J-Kid. It's like
– yes,
that's one. That was one of the highlights. It wasn't Twan, you know, a lottery pick. It wasn't Mike Finley. It wasn't Q. It wasn't these highly touted guys. It was P-Mac from Sircon, Joe. Like, if you was on the soil, you knew what that meant to us. You know what I'm saying?
And it wasn't just J-Kid, bro. I ain't gonna even lie. Like, Penny was on that Phoenix team, man. Mm. Penny was like, Penny Hardaway was like, man, that dude to me, man. J-Kid was that dude. But Penny, like Orlando Penny, what?
Yes,
when I got to Phoenix, man, it was so many good players. Sean Marion was young, and I knew him, had a real relationship with him. Cliff Robinson was good to me. It was a guy, Rodney Rogers was super cold.
Yeah.
White boy, Tom Gugliotta was super cold. Like, I just couldn't, like, the guys that I thought was weak and was scrubs, you would see them dudes and be like, man, this boy is a problem. Like, it just let me know that you got to work on your craft, man. The NBA is not as easy as everybody thinks. It's mental. Like, everybody in the NBA talented, like super uber talented. So you might see somebody that don't play for the Bulls or John Lucas or somebody like that, they're barely getting the game for the Bulls, and you'll catch him in the gym playing with you and your friends, and he'll show you why he's a pro. You know what I'm saying? I learned that, man, everybody in the NBA is in the NBA for a reason. And you know, it was just a dream come true to play with Jason Kidd, to meet some of the coaches and the players that I met, man. It was, I'm still speechless. I don't know how I pulled it off to this day, bro. I ain't lying.
Yes, sir. What's your, you know, some of your favorite moments from the NBA, whether it be you killing somebody, somebody killing you, like, what stands out the most?
I had 20 and a half against Vince Carter in Toronto in the NBA. It was one of the high points for me. I knew that the year before that, Vince had came to IIT.
Hey, we gonna get into that. We gonna get into that one down the line. That's one of my one of my favorite all time moments. But go ahead.
So Vince had came to IIT. So I knew that, you know, I could compete against him from previously playing against him. And I had, you know, caught that team that year. And they was trying to kind of have Vince on defense because me, Jason Kidd, and Sean Marion was the three perimeter players. So they put Vince on me, and they put their best defender on Sean Marion. They put Alvin Williams from Villanova on Jason Kidd. So I felt kind of disrespected, even though I was just a rookie. But I felt like, so y'all gonna put the person that plays the least amount of defense on me, like I'm trash, like I can't score. So I just got it going, and man, had 20 and a half. I couldn't really believe that in the NBA game. So, you know, those was one of the points that really stick out to me. Getting traded was another thing that stuck out to me, because it let me know that it was a business, and I was on such a high by being on a team with structure like Phoenix. Once I got traded and nobody told me, I didn't know, like, it's like I crashed. Like, I just came straight down, and I was on the low. So I immediately realized that the NBA is a business, and you a commodity, and you kind of like a piece of property, and you know they can move you around and basically treat you how they want to, because you their asset. So, you know, I just had to learn things, man, and just go through it to understand what it really was.
So you said you didn't know?
Nah, I ain't know. I got traded. I remember the exact, like, when it was and what I was. I was on Phoenix. We was in Boston about to play the Celtics. I had just left with Antoine Walker the night before. We had dinner. You know, he like, man, P-Mac and him in town. So he, you know, met up with us. We went out. We ate. Twan, you know, took me out to eat. So I'm getting ready for the game the next day. And the trainer actually, who, you know, brings you your stuff in your room, he said, Paul, you got traded. Like, the coach didn't talk to me. My agent didn't talk to me. I didn't hear from no GM, nobody came to the room. All the players got on the bus and went to the game. It wasn't even like I got to say, like, bye to them. You know what I'm saying? Like, everybody left to go to the game. I was still in my hotel room. Never got to say bye to the team. Never got to, like, address the team, nothing. Just, hey, you traded. You, Corey Blunt, y'all out of here. Y'all going to Golden State. I said, traded for who? Who the fuck did I get traded for? When they told me who I got traded for, I was so heated. I was so mad. I said, who I get traded for? He said, Vinny Del Negro. Oh, my Lord. I said, y'all traded two of us for this man? They was like, yeah, we need a shooter. We need shooting. Oh, man, bro. I was so hurt, bro. Oh, man. I was so hurt, man. So hurt, man. So I immediately realized it was a business, and you got to put your feelings in your back pocket. And man, get on with it. You're still in the NBA. So, you know, Golden State, here I come.
So you said going to a team, coming from a team with structure, like you said, you got these vets, Jason Kidd, Penny Hardaway, Rodney Rogers, Tom Gugliotta, and those guys. You go to Golden State, who's fairly just kind of, what would you say about them? Like, what?
Chaos. No structure. Team ran by all young guys: Larry Hughes, Bob Serra, Antoine Jameson, Chris Porter. We had a vet, Mookie Blaylock, but you know, it was just, man, at that time we wasn't the Golden State of today, right? So we was probably the second worst team in the league. I think Dallas may have been worse than us, but we was pretty trash, basically, to tell you, like, you know what I'm saying? This is a year before Gilbert Arenas and Jason Richardson came.
Okay.
Man, the whole team. The whole team was getting high. Like, some type of alcohol, drug, or opioid or something. Like, the whole team was getting high. So this is really the wrong place for me to go.
All day.
I already had a weed problem. Like, a lot of people who knew me already knew I had a problem with weed. So I'm leaving, like, a structured situation in Phoenix where I'm being held accountable. I'm being held responsible. Mm-hmm. And I go to a team that's just in chaos. Like, these niggas didn't practice if they ain't want to. Like, it was just crazy. Like, they ran over the coach. The coach was a Hall of Fame, a legendary Celtic, Dave Cowens, the center, a big left-hand guy. But he was just passive. Like, he had no reign over the team. The GMs didn't care. Like, man, niggas wasn't practicing. We had, like, a practice facility where we practice was on top of the hotel. So rookies and all the new people, they put us in the hotel. So we had an access key card. You can get in the gym anytime to go shoot. So I'm like, man, I ain't doing shit. I'm new in town. I'm finna go shoot. I go in the practice facility to just shoot. I ain't gonna name no players, like, specifically who they was. it's some players in the like in the hot tub in the shower area. They got chicks in the shower area. They smoking weed. They doing lines of coke. Now the next day, the whole team gonna be in this room. Trainers gonna be in this place. They in here like kicking it like in broad daylight. Threefold NBA vets, like NBA proven players. Players I'm not gonna name because I ain't gonna throw under the bus.
Right.
So I said, oh, it's on in here. Like, man, we can do whatever we want in here. So, man, I have my guys with me, man. I'm smoking weed, I'm selling weed, I'm carrying guns. I got to doing all type of stupid stuff, man. I was just rough around the edges. I wasn't really mature enough to accept my blessing and do what I needed to do with it. So, you know, long story short, it sped up the process on me removing myself out of the league. Yep. And I tell people all the time, being a pro is more than just on the court. You got to be a pro off the court. Like, you can't be getting in trouble. And I'm speaking from experience. I ain't telling these kids this from something I heard. I'm telling them this because I know, because I caught two felonies carrying guns that I didn't have a license for, and I got a UUW, and caught with pounds of weed, and I got an intent to distribute. So I'm speaking from pure personal experience. Like, listen, little bro, you can lose everything for this shit, and it's not worth it. You know what I'm saying? So, man, it was all life lessons and life experiences, but it was crazy going from Phoenix to Golden State. It was like going from a two-parent household to a your sister and them raising you or something, where you just got free reins and can do whatever you want. Like, it was kind of the worst thing to happen for me because I was hard-headed and I wasn't really a kid that listened at 21, 22.
Can you share some or give some insight on how or when you knew your NBA career was over, man? I feel like that experience at Golden State, I'm wondering, was that like the culture of the league at that time? Because I feel like a few years later, we know the situation with Gilbert Arenas.
Mm-hmm. And Javaris Crittenden.
Yeah, you know, with the straps on the plane and everything like that. But that is, I feel like, the NBA that I always wanted to know about, behind the scenes, that culture. But for you, Paul, how did you know it was over? And how did it hit you?
You breaking up, bro. I can't. It's going in and out. I can't hear. Could you repeat the question?
Can you hear me now? We all good? I think I'm a little still a little choppy on his side. Oh, man, I was just wondering about what it was like. How did it hit you?
I think I heard you, brother. T, I can't hear you, bro.
We're going to take a real quick break, Paul, and then we're going to come back and get you straight and continue the conversation. Everybody tuned in. We'll be right back. You're kicking it on the soil with the Bigs and Paul McPherson.
Sissy's Taco Bar Pop-Up is back with more hours and more days. Check them out at their new pop-up location at The Woodlawn, located 1200 East 79th Street. Sissy's Taco Bar offers authentic street tacos infused with international soul. Now every Tuesday, Thursday, Friday, and Saturday at The Woodlawn from 12 p.m. to 7 p.m. New vegan tacos have been added to the menu too. Visit sissytacobar.com for more info.
What's up, everybody? Welcome to the green side of things. It's your man, Sadiq.
And Cassiopeia.
And we need you to like,
comment,
and share
that thing
every Tuesday and Thursday from 1
to 3 p.m. on
What's In It for the Black People Media.
Parenting in a Pandemic, powered by the Chicagoland Mom Squad, hosted by me, Tennille Jackson. Today's guest will be Beulah McLeod. It's not 2021 that this is getting fixed. Focus on your child and let's figure out what's going to work individually for you, but respect that people are making for them and don't shame them for them.
Everybody makes different choices for different reasons and you don't know what somebody's situation is, and equity is not giving everybody the same thing. Equity is giving everybody what he or she needs to be successful. If you want to do remote should be high quality. If you want to come back, it should be high quality. It's not necessarily about the mode of delivery. It's about what is the quality level of any of those particular modes. We have to have empathy. Right now, I can see the teachers' argument. A lot of them are scared. I get that, right? I get the parents' argument. Everybody experiences that level of, I don't know how to help my baby with this thing. So parents are frustrated. We got to just try to see each other's perspective, and I don't think we do enough of that. I think we get locked into our own viewpoint. This is what I think, and that's just it, and that's why we can never get to a solution. We need options, because everything is not going to be good for everybody.
Where we live illegal, leaning off a leader, riding regal, tipping scales like Libras. Inhale, no L's, pulling out blocks like Jenga. In the rear of a Caprices, Billy Rams, flicking decent nonetheless. Nothing less than tears for the speakers. You'll hear us before you see us with beats that beat the streets up. So try and keep up and keep it low key, cuz police try and treat us and keep us on a leash, cuz that's how they see us, thinking we nuns, cuz we'll die for the ground beneath us, because this land made us, this land made of players that stay on paper. That's how we came up amongst the mayhem to the day when we display what we made of. The game can never change us, the West Side teachers, on these streets where you find that D before G. We out west with it, back down, trying to flip a dollar. If you look and then we got it, you just got up in a plot. We out west with it, riding clean, wetter than the sea, on the scene with a full tank, blowing AC. We out west with it, I'm posted, let me know what y'all on, cause if y'all get on something, then just hit my phone. We out west with it, yes, yes sir. Hustle for every penny in the trenches, but we turn struggle into stress.
Soil, having a great, great conversation with the one and only Paul McPherson, taking us throughout every nook and cranny of his journey, telling real stories, real behind-the-scenes stories of what it was like, not only in Chicago at that time, one of the greatest times of Chicago basketball, but his journey throughout the league, man. And when we get Paul back in a few moments, I can't wait to ask him about how he transitioned from his NBA career into his overseas career, and then also into what he's doing now with the shorties and the youth, because I feel like it goes without saying, man. I love how transparent he's being. I feel like the people he benefits most, or can benefit most, and being as open as he's been, is the younger generation. They got to hear it real.
From firsthand account.
Yes, man.
Yeah,
they need that.
Yeah, not just from some he say, she say, but from the
source
himself.
Yeah, some broad, you know, view of what life in the NBA, or on the path of trying to reach your goal of being an NBA, is actually like, you know?
And a lot of people, again, when you part of, you know, and that's the thing, like, Paul was a part of the special, probably to me, the most special time of Chicago basketball, because there was no, and I can't speak for the time before me. I can only speak from the time that I was a part of this, and you know, up until now. But yeah, that IIT pro-am run of like 8 to 9 years, where we look forward to every Friday and Saturday.
Just so the listeners know, ever since I've known Gene, he's been dropping these stories from these IIT runs since I've known him, Gene. I feel like every story is more legendary than the other one. Gee, it's crazy what was going down, and I wish we had something like that in the summer to cover now, but man, it's just a different time.
And these were the days when the pros came back and gave their time. It wasn't, I mean, I'm pretty sure they did a lot in the community. Some things we knew about, a lot of things we didn't know about. If you knew those guys personally, then you did know. But it was about giving the time and coming back and giving a weekend to the city.
Man,
and having the line around the block.
This is, you know, this is one of the meccas. I feel like The story Paul told about him needing to get back to the crib, even though he's doing this thing, hooping on another level, is something about Chicago basketball. I feel like, too, that era of Hooper, where they know that it was nothing like doing it on the soil here, you know?
No, it was a classic time, man. Like I said, I'm not sure. Paul said he was having issues getting back on. I don't know if he's going to come back today or not, but if he doesn't, we'll set up another one and finish the conversation.
Definitely got to set up a part two, because somebody needs to.
There's so much to unpack there.
Oh yeah. Man, oh something like that.
And that was just half of the story, Esco. He didn't even get into my favorite part of Paul McPherson.
When you touch down on the soil, man, you get the real story.
Yeah, yes. You do. And yes. Like I said, it was important to get Paul because I feel like he's the perfect representation of on the soil. Like, this is a guy who came from Sercon City. You heard him talking about the GD. Like, what's he?
But that's a part of the Chicago background. All you know what I mean?
Playing one, his first taste of that was playing one-on-one against Sly Polaroid.
Come on, man.
53rd. Now, I know exactly where he was talking about, at the park right across the street from Hales High School on 51st and Cottage.
Uh-huh.
And like he said, he was GD from Sercon. You know, Sly and them, they the T-Stones.
And he by himself.
By himself. Come in on. A park full of moles.
Come on, bro.
But the respect was there. The basketball was there.
Mm.
And he was able to hold his own, come away with a win, get the respect from the
moles.
About
to say, and get the respect.
Win money and leave out of there with the money
all of it. To tell the story to us.
That, I think that's the true representation of who P-Mac is. And like I said, if we talking Chicago basketball, especially that era, it's just no way that you, like I said, and we're going to get to this later, but my five favorite players from the Pro-Am, and mind you, everybody came through the Pro-Am. Now, I'm not comparing these guys because Vince came, KG, Steph.
See, that's crazy.
AI.
Though. That's insane, bro.
I'm
going to throw the correlation at you, our boy Rodney Circle 7 just said.
Uh-oh,
he said,
let me get back over, okay.
It was better than Rucker Park.
What? Rucker Park, and no disrespect, because I've been to Rucker Park, and I watched a couple games at Rucker. It was a different atmosphere. First of all, Rucker Park is outside. And New York street ball is not like Chicago street ball. It's a lot of showmen. Mm-hmm. It's a lot of showmanship in New York basketball. It's a lot of highlights.
A lot of flair.
Uh-huh. Yeah, that's where and one came from. So it's a lot of flair in this. And no disrespect, because them guys are A1 hoopers.
Mm-hmm.
But Chicago is a different breed, bro.
You see how he described it, that scratching claw.
What?
Fuck you up. Excuse me, but it's only one way to describe it. That's really the style of basketball. You will get bruised up out here.
I watched Lil Dave Bailey, Sed Banks, murder. I mean, absolutely destroy some of your favorite NBA players the Pro-Am, where it was no holds barred. We didn't care if you dropped 40, if you averaged 25 in the league the season before. When you step foot into the Pro-Am and it's 97 degrees.
Now, I remember, I've seen Sed Banks hoop a few. I mean, I remember that being a kid and seeing him go crazy.
Sed Banks, Lil Dave Bailey. Another mm-hmm. guy we're going to have on here soon, and we may be mm-hmm. doing something even bigger with him in the future. The Thrill.
The Thrill.
The Thrill. It's only one Thrill, Joe.
Yes, sir.
And that's Will Bynum. Lil Dave, Sed Banks, The Thrill, another guy P-Mac touched on, Mike Herman, who is still one of the illest. Look, man. One of the illest guys I've ever seen on a basketball court. Like I said, he gave Randy Brown a 60-pack at IIT in the midst of the three-peat. A 60-pack. And P-Mac. Lil Dave, Sed Banks, Thrill, Mike Herman, Paul McPherson. My top five favorite players ever at IIT. And again, I saw AI. You know Chuck is my second favorite player of all time.
Goes without saying.
Vince Carter, KG, Stephon Marbury, just to name a few. And, of course, all the Chicago pros. Every Chicago pro you can think of stepped foot in the IIT Pro-Am. Tim Hardaway, Twan, Ronnie Fields. Ronnie Fields wasn't a pro, but Ronnie, Mike Finley, Donnie Boy, Sherelle Ford, Shannon Brown, D Brown, Luther Head.
Yes, sir.
Eddie, whatever pro has ever come from Chicago in that era, they had to come through. D Rose.
What year did that stop over there?
I'm not sure. I'm not even sure. I can't even remember.
Because it's crazy. I feel like, do you remember the conversations we had with D Rose? That he's telling us how he's playing for money. And at his young age, that's a beautiful part. A crazy part, but when you look at it in its entirety, it's beautiful.
From the soil, man. These guys didn't have no bread. You didn't want, like P-Mac said, it was either you jump off the porch and get into the streets.
The origins of fantasy sports. You're like, I'm not going to play, but I got this.
I got a stack on Pop P-Mac.
Give me your best shorty. Yeah, come on.
Let's put them together. And that's either
nasty.
It was either that, Biggie said, either you slang a crack rock or you got a wicked jump shot.
Of course, that's what I was thinking about when he said his first test was against Sly Polaroid.
Come on, man.
Of course it is. You know what I mean?
Sly was raw as a hooper, but he was also that street guy.
Yes, sir.
So like he said, if you got the victory, you was lucky to walk up out of there with a W and the bread. So, again, we probably won't get P-Mac back. We'll have to set up another one, but
of course he's always welcome on the soil. Yeah, definitely one of the family members.
Yeah, he got a lot to. We still got a lot to touch on. I like how you left off because I think that'll probably sit with him, and that'll probably be the first thing we come back
with
because I'm sure he wants to continue to tell the depths of that story.
It's crazy that nobody has gotten in debt with him about that, with the journey that he's been on.
Come on.
Yeah, I mean, somebody should have been told the Paul McPherson story. I'm proud and honored to give him a platform to be able to tell it. I mean, and whenever part two commences, I'm looking forward to him getting into this IIT conversation and telling it from his perspective. But I feel like what he was passionate about is what he mentioned at the top of the interview, which is what he's doing with the youth now. So I can't wait to pick his brain on what he feels from his perspective the youth needs to know or what needs to be instilled into this new generation of basketball players. Because I feel like it is the consensus that the game has kind of dropped up or the quality of basketball has kind of went down in Chicago since that time? Like, what has happened to the game since then?
A lot has happened to the game since then. A lot of parents living through their kids. A lot of parents coaching.
See, now, with that said, of course, you see the rise of social media.
Right.
Those kind of go
everybody's
hand in
a
hand.
Trainer. Gee, everybody's a coach.
Yeah. I'm looking at YouTube early this morning at some of Paul McPherson's dunks, bruh. Gee, if Instagram was around.
Man, stop it. P-Mac would have had.
Come on. He lobbed it to himself in-game overseas. Over some 7-foot cat and threw it down on his head. I'm like, the audacity, how crazy do you have to actually be to do this in a game? It was insane, bro.
So when he talked, and I'm going to tell it, but I'm going to let him tell it, you know, from his own point of view. But my top three moment in IIT history, and he touched on it, Vince Carter. Vince came, another guy. So I said, AI, Steph, KG, Vince.
Should we hold it? Should we hold it for part two?
Or I mean, he'll touch on it.
Go ahead.
He may have a different outlook, or he may tell it from a different perspective because I was in the crowd. It was actually performing.
Right. Uh-huh.
So anytime, if you were plugged in, you would know who was coming to the Pro-Am that week. Okay. Like somehow it would get out.
It's like, so-and-so is coming.
Vince would be there Saturday at 5. So by 3:00, if you're not at IIT by 3:00, you're not getting in.
Not getting in.
Games don't kick off till 5. If you ain't there 2 hours before, there's no way you getting in. Vince comes. Gym is packed. It's 100 degrees in there. Going back and forth. Vince is Vince.
Of course.
Back and forth. One play down the court. Somebody's coming down the wing. They hit Vince in the middle of the floor. He takes one dribble. Boom. Reverse 360.
Stop playing, dog.
Reverse 360, though.
Stop playing.
Okay,
man.
A 360.
The other way.
A reverse 360.
No, G. So he spun it to his weak side. Okay.
He caught it here. One dribble. And yeah, exactly. Instant. Reverse 360. Yeah. So not
turn I can this see way. It. I can see it.
Windmill 360. Windmill 360. Sorry.
Oh, reverse bounce stuff.
Reverse windmill 360 off the bounce.
It's like, gee, did you know you was gonna do this? Like, fam. Okay, Vince Carter's in the building.
Come back on the other end.
Yes, sir. Cause you know that's only the beginning. Okay, in Chicago, that's only how it starts.
P-Mac gets Vince in the post.
Okay.
He pulls out the classic hood move, and I wish I could show it.
Go ahead, talk it down. Let me see.
So, it's that classic hood move. It's the crossover behind the back.
Uh-huh.
He had him in the post, felt him, put it behind his back, and then spent baseline. Left Vince way over there.
I'm somewhere. Already seeing him in the air, G. Come on.
Reverse.
About to say, I know what's next.
Touch his toes.
Yes, sir.
Everybody in the gym ran on the floor. Everybody in the gym ran on the floor. They stopped the game. They had to stop the game for like 10 minutes. Because nobody could believe that he just showed Vince. Like, we thought what Vince just did was it.
Vince Carter's in the, yeah.
No, P-Mac is in the building.
You on the soil, fam. Yes, bro. Sir.
Behind the back, spin move, baseline, touched his toes backwards. Bam! I'm talking about a frenzy. The whole gym ran onto the court. And that was just one of the many P-Mac moments at the pro. That's he killed at DePaul. You know, that was a special year for DePaul. Like he said, spent 2 years in the NBA, Phoenix and Golden State, played numerous years overseas. Overtime loss to Kansas. I remember that. Mm. That was what that picture was from.
Yeah.
The promo picture.
Mm-hmm.
Nothing. There was nothing like the Pro-Am at IIT. That's where you earned your stripes. That's when everybody was on the level playing field.
Man, who was putting that on? Like
Twan.
About to say, it couldn't have been a shoe company. You know what I mean?
Twan was paying that out of his pocket.
Wow, bruh.
Came to find out later down the years, Twan was paying most of that out of his pocket.
Just wow, bruh. Please, and shout out to Twan, because he's been on the soil. But man, does he deserve flowers or something like that? Because I feel like that's what's missing from the scene here. I know L.A. has the Drew League, and we went out a couple of years, and it was the same thing. James Harden came out, and it was the buzz. You know, if you're not there by a certain time, don't even try. But I know we've had Shy League here. We started doing our thing with Shy League, and that was basically my one-on-one introduction with
Pro-Am. So, yeah. Oh, right, because remember, he won the championship with Billy and Trash that year.
No, I know.
Right.
Come on, that was my...
And the Shy League was very competitive.
It lacked the star power.
Yeah, and it was just too commercial.
Yeah.
Like Nike, it was cool.
It was the new era of the shoe company calling the shots.
Running the shots, exactly.
Yeah, and it wasn't the streets. It wasn't about come kill. It was about this is who we have here. They going to play, basically. You know what I mean?
Are they really going to play? They just there.
Yeah, but see now, of course, Billy Baptist and them, they going to play. You know what I mean? They old school kind of, you know, so
right.
They came ready.
And those was Billy Baptist. And I'm not trying to compare Billy to Sed Banks and Lil Dave, but that was the comparison. Mm-hmm. It was like the guys who nobody – and if you were part of Chicago basketball, obviously you knew who Lil Dave, Bailey, and Sed Banks were Western House to UIC to Loyola.
I'm trying to tell you, I remember that my pops used to take us to UIC, and I watched Sed Banks ball. You know what I mean?
Crazy.
Yeah.
But these were guys who never made it to the pros. And I'm talking about there were pros there. Every game there was a pro playing. Man, I watched Lil Dave. Lil Dave was like 5'8", man. Putting them people in the post.
I remember, yes. that was the craziest thing as a short cat. I remember seeing him like, oh, yeah, these mugs can hoop too.
In the post, Esco. Like, mm-hmm. This little dude was putting guys 3, 4, 5 inches taller than him on the block, going crazy on him. Said Banks 6'2 at 6'3 at the most, 170 at the most, soaking wet. 50 packs on pros. Mm. It was unbelievable, man. So when we talk about basketball, man, I just feel like, and there were pro-ams before IIT, obviously Chicago State, when Mark used to tell us about playing with Michael Jordan. Even Mike played in the IIT pro-am. Tim Hardaway and Mike with the famous Tim gay Mike buckets at IIT. Like, IIT was it, man. And it was a must, bro. Like, I don't care what went on during the week. We were looking forward to Friday night, Saturday night, Sunday night.
And players are getting too much money now.
Like, they are.
Can you imagine D-Rose coming to play with the issues that he's had? It's like, nah.
Nah.
I'm not finna risk it for no paper.
Nah.
You know what I mean? So.
And the injury, you know, this is back when ACL injuries and meniscus injuries.
It was like, I ain't worried about that.
Exactly. Uh-huh. I'm from the soil. This is what we do. This is a must. Like, all the dope dealers used to be in there. All type of people used to be at the pro-am, man. It was something you had to be there to understand the magnitude of what the pro-am meant to Chicago basketball, man. It was like those summers, I remember them like yesterday, bro. Lines around the corner, Twan pulling up in a bit. You know, that's what you would do. You'd be sitting outside once you see, because the players, they parked right in front. Like, if you were a fan,
uh-huh,
you had to park in the lot behind or the lot across the street. The players, they pulled up right in front. So when you saw, when you outside and you see somebody pulling in front, you already know it's a player. So then when you see a Benz or a Bentley or one of them exclusives, you already know it's somebody coming to put in some work. But it was not sweet at all, bro. It was, if you ran up on Lil Dave, if you ran up on said Mike Herman used to come in that boy with his shoes in a plastic jewel bag.
Yes, sir. These is only for when I'm going after the kill. Okay, these ain't for fun.
The black not bag, fancy. The black bag not you get fancy. From Arab now.
Yes,
do
sir.
Work. Do work.
I got shoes in here.
I'll pull them out. It's gonna be a. Yeah. Yes, sir, man.
Yeah, man. P Mac, Joe. I'm happy we got a chance to chop it up with him for a minute, get a lot of exclusive content. We still got a lot more left.
A lot to unpack, a lot to uncover.
We'll chop it up with him when we lock it in. But like I just told him through text, man, he said, let's set up another one and we'll do it. I appreciate you guys for sharing your platform more than y'all know. And I told him, yeah, it's all love. We'll set it back up and we appreciate you more than you know, brother. So.
Saying, man, real family. Thank you, Paul. We're definitely. I'm looking forward to having you back.
It's home.
Yes.
So what are we gonna do, man? You want to take one more break before we finish it up?
Take a quick break. We'll be back in like 30, 60 seconds. We'll be right back on the soil, y'all.
Tune into Parenting in a Pandemic, powered by the Chicagoland Mom Squad, every Thursday at noon, right here on What's in It for the Black People Media.
You are listening to the most dangerous show in the morning.
Our Attorney General Kwame Raoul.
Well, I have reached out to the Hospital Association and the Med Society to talk about how proactively we can talk about implicit bias in healthcare and begin to address the situation system-wide, because I've also simultaneously directed my civil rights team to begin to look at that and look at ways that it may have manifested itself. We've done so historically with regards to the nursing home industry, where you've had some nursing home owners that staff disparately. So if they're in a black community, they won't have much staff as they will in a white community. We've taken that on from a civil rights standpoint, and we're prepared to take on other instances of implicit bias in healthcare.
Utilizing your office to investigate civil rights and healthcare as a civil rights issue. That's actually pretty powerful, and it demonstrates how we have to be working in coordinated efforts with our elected officials in places and positions of power.
It is.
As I take a sip of this fifth that makes me shiver, you could probably sell a ship on this river full of liquor. We stay afloat where hope drowns in addictions, a potent mixture. This is the picture that depicts us. We live it up, giving what we were given, gave our all, refused to give in or give up, willing to risk it all. Gee, we lived on a tip drunk, dug deep in the trenches, shit, we knew what the risk was. But of course, again, it's the same story when shots fired in the alley, hit shorty valedictorian. Where's the support for him, the less fortunate? Another life lost, another day in court again. 20 years for the defendant for any sort of grin. Ward of the state, he was raised in the orphanage. To where it all began, the source of it. Empty cupboards, floorboards, no money for the store again. That's all he knows.
Just where I come from, all of what I've learned, most of what I've done, I owe it all to the people that I love. I hope you're proud of me wherever I go.
All political, what you tripping for? The richest ones get riches from the richer ones. On the tip with hype, tippy toe, for a fix of blow, getting dope, running every type of give and go. No Philip Drummond in these different strokes. Where we come up on these risky roads, pray for a pot to piss in for the kitchen stove. Criminal capers just to get us on, bagging up the same order that gets us gone. Thinking maybe one day we may hit that goal. Until then, I'm outside until I flip this soul. Grabbing fagas from the sick go on Cicero. I see a visual of them people frisking, bro. Stretched out by a shorty with a grimace on. Sometimes it ain't even the money, it's the principle. Can tell you why we die, but what are we living for?
This is my city, just where I come from. All of what I've learned, most of what I've done, I owe it all to the people that I love. I hope you're proud of me wherever I go. I'm from
WIIFTBPM.
Shout out to the classic clips of you, Esco out over here reenacting Bill.
F it.
Yeah, we'll do it live. We'll definitely do it live here on the soil, live from the West End for the Black People Media Studios. Once again, shout out to Paul McPherson. I feel like every time we get a chance to share our platform, something special happens. So,
and shout out to everybody in the comments, man. I see everybody out there with their Paul McPherson stories.
Yes,
and
man.
I see Todd say he hooped with Todd before.
Shout out to Todd on the soil. Welcome, brother. Yes. That was cool seeing Ty Stroger in the comments finally, you know, sharing his hooping stories.
Todd hooping with Paul.
The odd couple. So, yeah.
And everybody else, man. I see Circle 7. I see Ray. A lot of people out there that are part of the Chicago hoop culture,
yes.
Whether they played or whether you know.
Live through it. Shout out to Ree. Shout out to Big Bro Brandon. I see you chiming in with Paul's Battlegrounds.
That was another MTV thing we didn't get to.
Man,
he was so high on the Battlegrounds.
Yeah, when he got to the semifinals.
He got to the semifinals and was so smoked out and tired he couldn't even finish. Because he was much better than the guy he lost to. But the guy he lost to, and which goes back to what he said, Paul made it all this way without even putting in the real work. He was just a naturally talented guy.
Yes.
And he was physically gifted, which kind of aided in the
majorly.
So if he put in the actual work, and you heard him say how we all knew he had a weed problem. Everybody that knew Paul knew that he was smoked out wherever he went. But
when he comes back, I'm just gonna let him know it's no such thing as a weed problem. But go ahead.
No, it's not. Because it didn't affect him on, obviously.
Let the NBA tell it. That was, yes,
that was his downfall.
The NBA was concerned, yes.
Yeah, but when Paul showed up, you knew he was off a four pack and he was giving out work. So, hey, man, good stuff from Paul.
But I feel like the part of the story where he told about his experience in Phoenix compared to Golden State. I mean, and Gino, sorry, I want you to tell me, Gino doesn't let me not know. Hey, you need a vet in the atmosphere. You know what I mean? And you see what it's like when it's not, and it's just anarchy.
You go from Penny, J-Kid, Tom Gugliotta, and Rodney Rogers to Larry Corey Hughes, Blunt. Corey Blunt.
Larry Hughes? Oh.
Who was kicking it with AI.
Yeah. From the Philly days.
Anton Jameson.
Young cat. Gilbert Arenas.
Right, the year before Gil got there. It worst team
kept
in the league.
Warm for Gil, for sure.
He made it, though, man. He was able to tell the story and, like you said, doing big things. I think Paul is now living in Florida and giving back to the youth, man. So interested to hear what he has going on and just give some more gems that these kids, you know, could use and take with them down the line.
Gino, can we talk about fans being back at the stadiums real quick? We got a few minutes left in the show, 5 minutes left. How do you actually feel about this? Because I got some interesting thoughts.
I'm so happy to hear fans are coming back. It helps me out.
True.
The aesthetic, man. I need the fans out there.
Especially at Wrigley, I feel like.
What is Wrigley without the fans?
Without the buzz from the fans just being in the building.
Yeah, this, you know.
I guess my perspective is different being on the South Side. You know what I mean? I want my people to come out to these games. You know what I mean? I chill in the crowd. You know what I mean? Just to, I'm like, hey, I'm here. Come see your boy.
But even with the Cubs, you hang out across the street.
Yeah.
So I wonder if those bars and restaurants.
Yeah, if the whole
are gonna be juking.
The whole experience.
Oh, they gonna say, oh, they gonna be juking.
Oh, they because what is it? 50% occupancy. I don't know about bars, but is this restaurants?
Right now, it's 50%.
Yeah, I think it's at 50% right now.
Okay.
I'm gonna be across the street.
Yeah. And who knows? I don't know what's in your
I'm
red
in the
cup.
Rooftop.
Yeah.
I'll see you guys.
Now, the rooftop was open last year.
The rooftop was open.
I do declare.
I'm pretty sure the tickets were a bit higher than they normally were.
Yeah,
they were.
They were actually astronomical.
It was crazy when you look out from the press box and you look at the roofs. And it's kind of empty over there.
Yeah, it was only one or two people.
It was scary last year.
Nobody really wanted to do that. Yet.
And I don't think they wanted to pay $400 for
Come
a ticket
on.
Either.
It's like, you know what?
I'm already paying $175. Now y'all want me to pay double?
Plus parking.
Plus parking.
Plus parking. You should really, everything else is in addition to the parking. You know what I mean? The parking is a hefty tag. But I got bootleg cable, so I didn't have any issues. But I'm sure
your
they
games
had the
come
issues.
On what?
They come on the marquee network, but it's just
White Sox.
Oh no, that's NBC Sports.
Right.
So I was always.
So your bootleg cable got marquee now?
Yeah, they do. I think a couple of months ago they added the Big Ten Network marquee. I feel like the Midwest package came over, so I'm good.
See, we got all of that on Hulu Live, but they took marquee off at the end of
I
last season.
I saw that.
Season.
I'm like, okay, so now they're back in the same boat. Like people are gonna have issues watching games again.
Well, I got the Fire Stick, so I'm gonna just pay my 50.
And if I ever I can share my pack, I don't know. I got you. You know what I mean?
Marquee. Y'all are trash.
Yeah, and honestly, you know what? We were actually planning the Bigs tailgate. We had people shop with us and bought tickets to the game. Shaquille was going to be hosting it with us. We was going to do something special.
Shout out Shake.
Always shout out Shake. But I don't know if we're necessarily going to get back to that yet. You know what I mean? We still got to see what the situation is going to be when they go above 20%. But when they do, you know what I mean, I really kind of feel like I want us to push our people to the ballparks this summer, the ones that are willing to get out. So,
hey, you know we're not getting out of here without the word of the day, right?
Can't. Drop it on us, Gino.
Esco, today's word of the day. Mm-hmm. Ethos. E-T-H-O-S.
Okay.
Ethos. It's a noun, and its origin is Latin, mid-19th century.
Mm-hmm.
Who speaks Latin? Anybody? You know anyone speaks Latin? No.
No, I'm over here thinking like I'm trying. I was about to say my dad, but no.
No. The definition. the characteristic spirit of a culture, era, or community as manifested in its beliefs and aspirations.
See, is that ethos?
It's not ethos.
So, yeah, go ahead, break it down. It's ethos. Ethos.
The party wholeheartedly embraced the ethos of the 1970s, from bell bottoms to disco.
Oh, yeah.
The Academy was founded on an ethos of self-improvement and hard work. Ethos.
The ethos of the Bigs is to keep it played all times.
It knocked it out the park, man. I think we can end today's installment on that note, bro.
Please keep it played, y'all. Gino, get us up out of here, man.
Hey, man, we appreciate everybody who locked in with the brothers today. Again, special shout out to our boy P-Mac, Paul McPherson, one of Chicago's finest. We see Herb Howard, one-third of the kickoff kickback on the other side of the glass, over there holding it down with the hardest working producer in all
Esco
of the land. Esco doing all the hard work, man. We appreciate Escobar you guys.
Season has returned.
Esco season has returned. I wish we could play Esco 97, but we might get flagged for that.
No flags. We just going to keep it without the background now.
Hey, man, up next, the brothers.
The gods.
I said what I said.
Shout out to the real family, everybody that tuned in today.
Man, Cousin 2, Herb, Intellectual Thuggery at its absolute finest. Y'all tune in with the brothers, man, Monday through Friday, 3 to 6 p.m. on the What's In It for the Black People Media Network. Man, y'all know how we do at the Bigs, man. Show love, spread love, stay away from the haters. Circulate the dollar with your people, man.
Do it.
I went in on Cuz and them last week, and when I got to the crib, my sir and madam pack was waiting on me.
Spoke it right up, so I have no worries.
It wasn't sir and madam's fault. It was the post office who I needed to.
Which is trash, and I'm going to be wearing some of the stuff I got to a wedding, so shout out to sir and madam.
Okay. But yeah, man, circulate the dollar with your people, but man, most importantly, always keep it player, man. A lot of non-unplayer individuals running rampant in these streets. Esco, keep your third eye open, Esco.
Always.
Mm-hmm.
On that note, the brothers up next. Until Wednesday, for myself, for my player partner, T-Tom.
It's us.
We out of here, man. Much love again to P-Mac. Much love to the family members in the comments. There would be no the Bigs. There would be no on the soil without y'all, man. Until Wednesday, much love. We out.
WIFTBPN